10-year-old male child residing at Orissa was admitted in the hospital with chief complaints of bluish discoloration of nail beds and lips since 1 year of age and dyspnea and exertion since last 2 years. History of present illness, the patient was apparently well till 1 year of age. Mother noticed bluish discoloration of skin and nail beds. The bluishness increased during crying, decreased after roaming in mother's lap or knee chest position, suggestive of cyanotic spell. There were no history of unconsciousness, seizure, loss of tone during crying. No history of recurrent LRTI, feeding difficulty or perspiration over forehead during feeding. Now, gradually the spells diminished from 2 years of age onwards and mother noticed frequent squatting posture of the child from then. The child could go to school and play with peers. But the child complained of dyspnea and exertion for last 2 years with limitation of activities. The child cannot go to school or even he became dyspneic on climbing one flight of stairs, that is NYHA3 now. There was no history of associated convulsion, abnormal movement, swelling of limbs, decreased urination, consciousness, loss of consciousness, prolonged fever or hemoptysis. No history of hospital admission. Now, the parents consulted local pediatrician and echocardiography was done at Cuttack at 3 years of the age, but they were referred to higher center. But due to financial constraints, they could not go. At 5 years of age, the child was again re-evaluated at another center and there was a cardiac catheterization was done, but there was no documentation of it. And parents were told that the child is having a complex congenital heart disease will require high-risk multi-stage surgical repair. But they didn't proceed it then also. And now, after getting funding from the Odisha government, they have come to our hospital at 10 years of age. We have done CT scan and also we are planning for a repeat cath of the patient.
Okay, you go back to the first slide. That's a great history. Let us analyze each one threadbare. Okay, the first one.
The first one is the bluish discoloration of skin and nail beds for 1 year, from 1 year of age.
So the cyanosis is there. That means it is a cyanotic congenital heart disease. Okay. Now here we have to find out whether the cyanosis was on day one or it came after 6 months or 1 year. Because if the cyanosis were there on day one, then you'll have to think of what conditions. Can you name
ma'am, TGA, ma'am, TGA, then ma'am, pulmonary atresia or yes. Critical PS.
Yes.
With right to left PFO.
Okay. Then?
And ma'am. Ma'am, severe tough with no forward flow. At, that is.
Truncus arteriosus.
Okay. Truncus arteriosus.
And tricuspid atresia.
Okay, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. These are the conditions that we think if it is on the day one. But it so happens that many a times when the duct is there, the cyanosis may not be seen on the day one.
Yes,
ma'am. So even if these conditions are there, we will not be able to make up. That the parents cannot make out because the duct is supplying and as a result, the cyanosis may not be obvious until the duct closes. Or the duct becomes inadequate. The child grows so that whatever the blood is coming from the duct is not adequate. So that is what you think. Now, do you think that the child had a spell or no?
Actually, mother could notice from 1 year, but I think that the cyanosis started from 6 months onwards, I think. So that it became apparent to mother to notice.
Okay. Now, this history, what you have given, it is not exactly classical cyanotic spell. But it is resembling akin to a spell, which we are assuming it's a spell, but may or may not be spell. Okay. But this is not a classical history. But anyway, by crying, the cyanosis is increasing. That means it is a decreased blood flow.
Blood flow, yes. And ma'am, there is an infundibular component also.
Okay. So probably there is a decreased blood, pulmonary blood flow situation and causing the cyanosis. Now here, gradually, the spell, whatever you say, it disappeared. The mother noticed frequent squatting, you said. Okay. Why do you think the squatting occurs? What is the mechanism of squatting?
During squatting, first of all, there is a kink in the femoral artery. So there, it increases the afterload, and so there is more blood shunting towards the pulmonary circulation. Number two, ma'am, there is increase in the venous return from splanchnic circulation to the right side of the heart, so that there will be more and more QP. So, ma'am, the saturation, that is the cyanosis, decreases. As the child grows, ma'am, he also can acquire some squatting equivalence because of some peer pressure or etc. So he may lie down, he may stand cross legs.
Okay. So you say that not only the squatting, even lying down, or just, you know, like this, or even like a Krishna position, no?
Yes, ma'am.
What is Krishna position? Just crossing the legs.
Crossing the legs, yes.
Yeah, crossing the legs also can do this. And this is very important, because why does the child learn the squatting? How does it learn?
Because, ma'am, in front of all the same age group, he feel embarrassed. So, as he learns to walk and squat, he acquires those maneuvers automatically.
That is not the social problem. The actually scientific reason is, whenever the desaturated blood comes into the iota has got both chemoreceptors and the baroreceptors. So when the deoxygenated blood comes, these are stimulated. So there is a hypertension, and also, you know, the child starts feeling giddy.
Okay.
Avoid falling down, it sits down.
Okay.
Once it sits down, as you said, you know, the femoral, the afterload increases, and as a result, the right to left shunt comes down. And instead, more deoxygenated blood from the splanchnic and the renals, you know, it comes to the right ventricle, and as a result, the child may feel better. So that is the mechanism. So here, the child has gone otherwise all right. And then what you have seen is the child is in NYHA class 3 for the past 3 years. That is quite a significant reduction in the pulmonary blood flow. And as a result, you have to think in terms of cyanotic congenital heart disease, where the decreased blood flow is there. So truncus arteriosus is unlikely.
Likely.
Invariably increased blood flow. Of course,
yes,
can have decreased also. Then TAPVC is unlikely. This is not the mechanism, the presentation. And then it is unlikely to be... like tetralogy of Fallot, which is the classical one, but we cannot rule out. But pulmonary atresia can be possible, tricuspid atresia can be possible, DORV can be possible. So we have so many other possibilities. And then we can think that here, you said no history of convulsions. What is the mechanism of convulsion and why the convulsions occur?
In a smaller child, that is less than 4 years, due to hyperviscosity, there are microthrombi. So microinfarcts may cause convulsion. But after, in the elderly, there will be brain abscess, chance of brain abscess. They can cause convulsion. And ma'am, finally, as the age progresses, the cyanosis also progresses. So the blood becomes more thicker. So there is chance of CVA and other things.
Yeah. The two reasons. Whenever there is a hypoxemia, very severe hypoxemia is there, then the brain gets stimulated, the cortical cells, and they get the convulsions. So convulsions means it is a severe cyanosis, and as a result, child is developing the convulsions. So every time the child gets convulsions and goes to cyanotic spell, so much of damage will be done. That is one thing. But as the child grows up, becomes 8 to 10 years, and at that time they can have brain abscess, and that also can cause the convulsion.
Convulsion, yes.
Why the, what is the mechanism of brain abscess?
Right to left shunt, so that there is paradoxical embolism to the systemic circulation, which causes brain abscess.
Now what happens is, normally our lungs acts as the filter. Okay, whatever the bacteremia occurs, they are filtered in the lungs. So by the time they go to the left side, it goes to the lungs, filtered and comes to the pulmonary vein and to the left ventricle and aorta, the blood becomes pure. But here there is a right to left shunt, or the desaturated blood is going directly into the aorta, and as a result that the lung filter is taken away. The natural lung filter is taken away, so the bacteremic blood directly goes to the brain and the blood-brain barrier is crossed. So once the blood-brain barrier is crossed and the bacteremic blood goes to the brain, already there is a hypoxemia, then thrombosis because of the and because of that there are micro-infarcts. These micro-infarcts act as a nidus for infection.
To grow.
So the organism to grow. And that's the reason they develop the convulsions. But invariably, when the convulsions occur with brain abscess, they will have a projectile vomiting, persistent projectile vomiting associated with the severe headache and fever. So the fever, headache, projectile vomiting with the convulsions give an indication, and also with the neurological deficit indicate that there is a brain. Now here the child doesn't have any of them. Okay. Swelling of limbs also is not there. Invariably, the congestive cardiac failure is unlikely in a decreased pulmonary flow. The congestive cardiac failures occur more when there is a pulmonary hypertension or congestive cardiac failure as a consequence of that.
So I thought that in a growing tough or in a fallow physiology, there may be RV dysfunction, RV may fail, so right-sided heart failure.
Yeah, the RV dysfunction can occur only when there is a suprasystemic RV pressure. See, otherwise what happens, the left ventricle, right ventricle are easily decompressing into overriding aorta, and as a result, there will not be congestive cardiac failure. So congestive cardiac failure presenting as a pitting bilateral edema or the sacral edema is extremely rare.
Yeah.
Only in the adult tetralogy. What are the causes of congestive cardiac failure in adult tetralogy?
One is, ma'am, hypertension. Okay. Then, ma'am, infective endocarditis, anemia.
Okay.
Then, ma'am, AR, aortic regurgitation may cause LV dysfunction followed by RV dysfunction biventricular.
Okay. What else? Aortic regurgitation. Then, suppose, invariably in tetralogy, there is a non-restrictive, a large VST. And as a result, RV, LV pressures are equal. And there is no hangout interval. Suppose by chance there is some reason where the VST becomes restrictive, at that time the RV pressure becomes
Hoffman variety of TOF.
Yes. And at that time the JVP may be raised, liver may be palpable, and the edema may occur. So here those things are not there, so we rule out that. So go to the next slide.
Yes, ma'am. This is the treatment history.
Okay, in the treatment history, we can get very important clues if the parents are educated and if they give you the thing. Many a times in the examination, the diagnosis is given by the parents to the.
Yes.
So, but it can be like a double-edged sword. You know, you get into
trouble. Yes, ma'am.
I have not got the clue, so let us discuss. So, patient consulted a local thing. And echocardiography was done. And this is very important. If it was a simple tetralogy of Fallot, they would have said the intracardiac repair will be done and the child will be fine. Because as on today, with the techniques and technologies, almost all over, the tetralogy of Fallot, the complete correction is absolutely good in most of the centers. Since they have said it is a multi-stage surgical repair, and it is a complex congenital heart disease, we have to think out of the box and not the tetralogy that we were thinking till now. Okay. So if it was a simple tautology, they would not have said it is a complex one, and they would not have said it is a thing. So
multi-staged.
Yeah. So what are the possibilities?
Then it is a possibility that it is a DORV with non-rootable VSD, or ma'am, single ventricle physiology, tricuspid atresia with PS. Okay. So that it may require Glenn followed by Fontan.
Okay. Then, like pulmonary atresia.
Okay. So mitral atresia with hyperplastic LV with a PFO.
So those are the complex ones where, you know, in a single go, you cannot do the complete correction. So they have to do stage by stage. Suppose the TCPC has to done, as you already said, first go with the Glenn, where the superior vena cava is connected to the pulmonary artery. And then later on in the second stage, the inferior vena cava is connected either through conduit or directly. So through the thing. And these are the staged ones. Or pulmonary atresia. So we think in terms of either pulmonary atresia or tricuspid atresia or a single ventricle physiology of any other thing. And apart from that, a DORV.
DORV, non-rootable VSD.
So these are the possibilities that come to our mind. So here, you know, the patient did not proceed for the surgery, and then they came with the child had undergone catheterization. So the catheterization was done and the whole picture was given and everything was explained. Can you go to the next slide?
Yes, ma'am.
So is there anything contributing here? The birth is...
There is no history of congenital heart disease in the family and he is first in birth order. But ma'am, there is a significant history of developmental delay. There is neck holding at 9 months, sitting without support at 12 months. So that developmental quotient is decreased. And speech is also delayed up to 2 years. This is a cyanosis, I think.
Basically, both motor milestones and the mental milestones, both are...
Ma'am, global developmental delay, I can say.
Global developmental delay, that's fine. Okay, what could be the cause for the global developmental delay?
Ma'am, cyanosis and micro-infarct hypoxia, which is not apparent after birth. The child cried after birth, but there may be subclinical hypoxia which may develop in the course of time.
No, this is very nice. In fact, the cyanotic children, though there is a delay in the development, you know, they are very, very kind. I have to tell you an incident. A cyanotic top where baby used to come and was not able to get up and stand. And then the mother was more worried about the milestones, the delayed motor milestones. And then one day the baby was sitting and playing and saw in the television that I was speaking, and it got so excited and it got up. So the child got up because of me. But if happens, the motivation has to be there. And then, you know, most of the cyanotic children, they're afraid. With the activity, they start feeling giddy, and as a result, there will be delayed milestones also. So here, whether there is any, syndromes are there or not has to be kept in mind.
Yes, ma'am.
If the syndromic child, these delayed milestones are more...
More prominent.
Okay, go ahead.
From the history, I have just conglomerated to some differential diagnosis.
You said about the oral medicine, so I'm going to go back.
Yes, ma'am. Only, ma'am, iron syrup was given to the child. Iron syrup.
So that means the propranolol, which is Indirol, which is commonly given for tetralogy, is not given.
Not given, ma'am.
Not given. That means it is not a tetralogy of Fallot. So the history tells us that one, regular Indirol is not given, and then the spells are not classical.
Classical, yes.
They have said complex congenital, straight, all this rule of the tetralogy of Fallot. So we are dealing with something more complex, and yes, that's what we have to keep in our mind and go ahead.
Ma'am, I have just kept Fallot physiology because it is more common. Then single ventricle physiology, because from the history, then I will confirm in my general examination and clinical examination.
Baitri, you are absolutely right. So probably 40 years back, you know, when I was a student like you, our teachers used to say, any 10 years old child with cyanosis, make the diagnosis of petrology of fallot. 90% of the time, you are right. Because only they survive till 10 years. And as a result, that is the first thing. But however, now the things are advanced. And we have analyzed with the catheters, catheterization done, and the diagnosis given to them that it is not a tetralogy. So it could be like a single ventricle physiology possible. Okay, go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, examination, patient was alert, conscious, cooperative. Anthropometry, weight was 16 kg, 5th percentile as per CDC growth chart. Length was 112, sorry ma'am, height was 112 centimeter, 5 to 15th percentile according to CDC growth chart. Pulse was 100 per minute regular, normal in volume, or peripheral pulses were palpable. No radioradial, no radiofemoral delay. BP was 90/72 per millimeter of mercury in the right upper limb, measured with appropriate size cuffs, and 112/86 in left lower limb. Respiration was 25 per minute without any retraction, or all quadrants were moving with respiration. Pallor, jaundice absent, cyanosis present. Clubbing was grade 3 in pan-digital clubbing. Saturation was 63 in all four limbs, measured with a appropriate probe, and there was no presacral edema, no pedal edema. Neck veins, JVP, were elevated with prominent A and V waves.
Okay. I heard you have presented very nicely. What are the highlights here? Cyanosis is there, clubbing is there. So that is 100% we are right that it is a cyanotic congenital heart disease. Then JVP is raised. Usually in tetralogy, JVP is not raised because RV is able to decompress into the overriding aorta without raising the pressure. So the RV pressure, which is systemic, is not transmitted to the right atrium.
Yes.
And as a result, the JVP is not raised. But it can be raised when there is a suprasystemic RV pressure. When there is a tricuspid regurgitation, then the JVP can be raised. But the JVP is raised in a single ventricle-like situation. So what are the possibilities?
First of all, I may think of diastolic dysfunction due to chronic hypoxia, which causes prominent A wave. Okay. Then, ma'am, relative stenosis of one valve, that is tricuspid stenosis, is there, or tricuspid atresia, JVP may be increased, and there may be TR or one valve regurgitation that may cause increase.
Okay, so we will keep the possibilities, and as we further go and examine, then we can rule out all these possibilities.
Yes, ma'am.
That's right. Okay. Yes.
Ma'am, then facies was normal. There was no skull and spine deformity. No radial defect, tone was normal.
So that then means a syndromic lesion.
Syndromic is ruled out.
Okay, ruled out. Okay, fine.
My precordial examination, inspection and palpation I have conglomerated. There is no precordial bulge, no scar mark, no venous prominence, no visible impulse over precordium. Apical impulse is at left fifth intercostal space, 1 centimeter inside the midclavicular line, RV type of apex with lateral retraction. Epigastric impulse is absent. Left parasternal leaf grade 2 is present. There is no thrill. There is a palpable second heart sound at right second intercostal space, aortic area.
Okay. Now I have a doubt. You are saying that the apical impulse is not shifted downwards and laterally. That means there is no LV. So,
no LV.
Careful what you are telling. And on other side, you are saying that it is diffuse, so you are unable to make out, localize it. So even if there is the LV dilatation, you are not able to make out. That's what you are saying. And then you are saying that it is like an RV type of apical impulse. If it is RV type of apical impulse, then your tricuspid atresia is ruled out.
Ruled out, yes, absolutely.
Right. Then you are thinking in terms of the right ventricle. And the right ventricle and on the other side, you are saying that epigastric impulse is absent. So if the epigastric impulses are absent, That means the RV dilatation is not there. So these two are contradicting.
Okay, ma'am.
Every time what you have to do is, as a good clinician, you have to use your index finger, put it in the Xiphi sternum and feel for the RV impulses. If the index finger is unable to feel the RV impulse in the Xiphi sternum, that means there is the right ventricle is smaller in size, like in a tricuspid atresia. So here, the absence of epigastric pulsation does not rule out the RV dilatation or absence or the hypoplastic right ventricle. So you should have done the palpation with the index finger in the Xiphi sternum. It's a must. So that rules out whether the RV is hypoplastic or not.
So that I should examine another time, because I have failed left parasternal lift. So I must examine another time to see whether epigastric impulse is there.
Because there is an absence of RV impulse in the Xiphi sternum, and if it is the apical impulse is LV type shifted downwards laterally, with
yes, ma'am, it is a tricuspid atresia.
Left ventricle. But on the contrary, if there is a right ventricle apical impulse and RV impulses are felt, then you can think in terms of the DORV. So this is a very crucial examination, and it is a must that you have to do it. Okay? Well.
Ma'am, percussion right border is rectosternal, left border corresponds to the apex. The left second intercostal space is resonant. The upper border of liver tunnels is at left fifth intercostal space, and stomach tympani is on the right side.
Okay.
Auscultation, S1 is normal, no split. S2 is loud, single. S3, S4 is absent. There is a constant vascular click at left third intercostal space. No other sounds. There is an ejection systolic grade 3/6, harsh crescendo decrescendo murmur, heard at supine posture with diaphragm of the stethoscope. No diastolic murmur.
Okay, now here we'll say S1 is normal. So we don't know whether the M1 and T1 both are there or not. We cannot make out. Only if there is an Epstein's anomaly, the T1 will be very loud. And if there is mitral stenosis, the M1 will be loud. But otherwise, the difference between M1 and T1 cannot be made out normally. So that's okay. Now, the most crucial point is the S2 is also single. So, when there is a single S2, what are the conditions that you think of?
Number one, if there is one valve, that is pulmonary atresia. Okay. Then, ma'am, severe valvar infundibular PS, the P2 will be so soft that we can hear a single heart sound. Then, ma'am, in truncus arteriosus, we may get S2 single. And then, ma'am, in pulmonary hypertension also, we may get single S2.
No, there it will be narrow, and the P2 will be loud and palpable.
Oh, ma'am, in this case, it is only thing that the aorta is anterior. So we can get only aortic sound with severe PS, because I am getting one ESM.
Okay. Now use your common sense and tell me, whatever the second sound that you are hearing, is it A2 or P2?
A2, ma'am.
Huh?
A2, ma'am.
Why do you think it is A2 and not P2?
Because, ma'am, as there is a cyanotic heart disease, so I am also getting an ejection systolic murmur. So there is severe PS, valvar and infundibular. So, and the aorta is also anterior. So, ma'am, I am just thinking that it is a A2. It most probably A2.
Now, all the time we were saying that it is a decreased pulmonary blood flow.
Blood flow, yes.
So once there is a decreased pulmonary blood flow, it is likely to be A2. So, where both the ventricles are pumping into the aorta. So, all the circulation is going into the aorta and very little to the pulmonary artery. That is one thing. Now, if it is a truncus arteriosus, that is a true single second sound, because there is no mitral valve, the pulmonary valve at all. So, the true single second sound is heard in the truncus arteriosus. But in case of tetralogy also, you can hear the single second sound. What is the mechanism?
Because ma'am, due to severe infundibular and vulvar stenosis, the P2 is so soft that we cannot hear it, and the aorta is also dextrorotated, so the aorta is anterior. So we hear the A2 component more prominently.
Okay. Anything else?
I mean, TGA physiology also the pulmonary is posterior, so we can get single A2.
Okay.
TGA. And pulmonary atresia, ma'am, there will be single A2.
Pulmonary atresia, again, it is not there. Anything else? Sometimes there can be absent pulmonary valve.
Okay, ma'am.
So the pulmonary component will not be there. But most often what happens is when the right and the left ventricle, they are decompressing simultaneously, there is no hangout interval. So it is the hangout interval which splits the second sound. When there is no hangout interval, they are almost occurring simultaneously at the same time. And our ears cannot hear the split unless it is more than 30 milliseconds.
30 milliseconds.
Okay. So that can happen when there is no hangout interval and both the ventricles are compressing simultaneously. And that can happen in a single ventricle situation also.
Okay. Yes,
so single ventricle situation, you can have a single second sound. Pulmonary atresia, you can have single second sound. Truncus arteriosus, single second sound. So here, we did not think in terms of truncus arteriosus by history. So that is more unlikely. Now coming to your vascular click, how do you distinguish between the vascular click and the valvar click?
A valvar click will be, in case of ma'am, pulmonary valvar click, it will be more prominent in expiration. So it is not constant, but in vascular click, it will be constant.
Okay. So whether it is a bicuspid aortic valve or a bicuspid pulmonary valve, both of them can have a vascular click. So that is aortic stenosis and pulmonary stenosis, both can cause the vascular click if there is a bicuspid aortic or the pulmonary valve. If it is a bicuspid aortic valve with the click, your murmur will be conducted to the carotid. So here it is not there. So aortic valvar click is ruled out. Then pulmonary valvar click will be varying with the respiration. So that because the venous return and this thing will be varying, and the valvar click will be varying with the inspiration and expiration. So that is not there. So constant click indicates that it is more of a vascular click. Now, where all do you get the vascular click?
Because of the dilated aortic root, ma'am, I can get a vascular click. In case ma'am, pulmonary hypertension or idiopathic dilatation of PA, we may get also the pulmonary vascular.
Yes. Idiopathic dilatation of the pulmonary artery also can have the vascular click. But idiopathic dilated pulmonary artery will not be cyanotic.
So that is another thing.
That is ruled out. Now, whether it is the aortic click or pulmonary artery click, it is unlikely to be pulmonary artery click because we said that it is a decreased pulmonary blood flow. So from the history onwards, we have been thinking in terms of the decreased pulmonary flow. So it is more likely to be an aortic vascular click. Okay. Now coming to the murmur, you said ejection systolic murmur, grade 3/6, it is harsh. Okay. Now, decrescendo, once you say ejection systolic murmur, it is a diamond shape. You don't have to mention crescendo, crescendo. But when you are describing a murmur of the ventricular septal defect, you use the word crescendo, decrescendo. So when there is a large VST, it is only decrescendo. When it is a small VST, it is a crescendo, decrescendo. Okay. So here it is heard and it is heard with the diaphragm, and it is in the aortic area. No, it is
your aortic area, ma'am. Left third intercostal.
So once
the mandibular region, yes, ma'am.
So it is unlikely to be due to the pulmonary stenosis because it is not heard in the pulmonary area. Best heard in the pulmonary area, and lower down it could be due to a VST. So it could be due to the VST. It is unlikely to be due to the tricuspid regurgitation because it will be heard much lower down, and it will not
be pan-systolic.
It will be pan-systolic, and then you know you'll hear it like a soft one, not a harsh one. So because it is a harsh one, it is heard in the left third and the fourth intercostal space. It is more likely to be due to the VST rather than a thing. Now, where all do you get the VST? In a DORV with the VST?
Yes, ma'am.
It is an obligatory shunt. So, VST is a must, and there has to be left to right shunt in a DORV. So, there you hear. And in case of tricuspid
respiratory, ma'am, with sub-PS, subvulvar PS.
Yes, there also you hear the VST murmur.
The paloventricular foramen.
So now we have come down to two conditions, either due to the DORV, VST-PS, or it is a tricuspid atresia, VST-PS. So those are the two conditions we are thinking till now. Okay, go ahead.
Other system, I have already mentioned, ma'am, the upper border of liver dullness is at the left fifth space, no organomegaly, and stomach tympani is on the right side. The respiratory system is normal. Sorry, ma'am, the respiratory rate is 25. It is a printing mistake. In CNS, ma'am, the child is alert but irritable, no neurodeficit, no abnormal movement. So, ma'am, should I summarize?
Yeah, go ahead.
So, my child is a 10-year-old male child with cyanosis in 1 year of age, clubbing of grade 3, dyspnea on exertion for last 2 years. On examination, the saturation is 63%. With pulse volume normal, delayed motor milestone and speech, elevated JVP with prominent A waves, situs inversus levocardia with a vascular aortic click, loud palpable single S2 with a ejection systolic murmur at the near aortic area.
Okay. So what do you think with this?
I think it is a cyanotic congenital heart disease, situs inversus levocardia, reduced pulmonary blood flow, single ventricle of RV morphology, severe PS, in sinus rhythm, no features of infective endocarditis, elevated JVP, post cardiac catheterization, post CT scan at NYHA 3 at present.
Okay, so what is the possible thing?
DORV, non-rootable VSD, PS. Then, ma'am, heterotaxy syndrome with unbalanced AVSD with dominant RV, because I have finding situs inversus, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. Or heterotaxy syndrome. Okay. So, if it is a DORV VST-PS, invariably, it will mimic like a tetralogy of Palo.
Yes.
But then the parasternal heave and the parasternal pulsations will be there. And otherwise, literally, it is almost the same like a tetralogy of Palo. So, vascular click, of course, aortic click can be there in both. Okay, unbalanced, possible. Now, with this, you know, we have to take the other investigations into consideration to make the diagnosis.
Yes, ma'am.
So, we'll go with the ECG.
Yes, ma'am. I have the ECG, ma'am. This is the ECG. Now I am describing it. It is a 12-lead ECG with normal, with ma'am, negative P wave in 1 and AVL.
Okay.
So ma'am, the P wave axis is negative. Along with that, ma'am, the in 2 and AVF also the P wave axis is negative.
Oh.
And ma'am, there is prominent R wave in V1 to V3 with prominent S wave in V5, V6. So there is RV dominance.
Okay, excellent. Now here the axis is, you said, what axis?
P wave axis is negative. So ma'am, atrial situs is inversus.
Okay. So, you know, unlike in case of tetralogy where there is a right axis, RVH, and then sudden transition between
transition, V, yes, ma'am.
That is not there.
Not there.
And also you can see that ST changes are there. The ST segment depression and fast wave inversion is there, and that is not a feature of tetralogy of Palo. So that happens only when there is a RVH with the strain pattern. So there is an RVH with the strain pattern, and the P waves, you know, like do you call it as a P congenitally?
Ma'am, pardon?
Do you think in terms of P congenital here?
I don't know what's being congenital. Please explain.
Okay. So here, this is not giving us a clear picture. But anyway, tricuspid atresia is ruled out.
Yes, ma'am.
In tricuspid atresia, the RVA will not be there in V1. And then there will be like a QR pattern. And the presence of RV, that is the tall P waves, I mean R waves in V1, it just rules out the tricuspid atresia. So we are left with either DORV.
Ma'am, heterotaxy. Yes, ma'am. Single
ventricle.
Yes. Ma'am, this is the skyagram of chest and upper part of abdomen showing a just midline centralized liver. And I could not elicit the stomach bubble here. And the apex is on the left side, and it is a RV type of apex, ma'am. With ma'am, the aortic knuckle is in the right side, so it may be a right aortic arch.
Correct.
And ma'am, the bronchial situs, it is clearly seen. The left bronchus is more vertical, so it is situs, bronchial situs is inversus.
Excellent.
And ma'am, there is a lacy pattern of the lung. So ma'am, there are multiple collateral here.
Yes, sir. That is excellent. Because if it were just a tetralogy or a DORV with the PS, you know, there will be hypovolemia with the reduced blood flow. And this reticular pattern, what you call it as a lacy appearance, that indicates that there is a multiple collaterals are there. So the multiple collaterals, they are not like a primary, secondary, tertiary branching of the pulmonary tree. See, normally right and the left pulmonary arteries, they branch into like a primary, secondary, tertiary branches. But here, the lacy appearance or a reticular appearance indicate that there are multiple aortopulmonary collaterals.
Yes, ma'am.
Abscess are in plenty. And invariably, you have to take the history of hemoptysis. You took the history and there was no history of hemoptysis. That is fine. So I agree that clearly it is a right-sided aortic arch. And then there is a RV type of apical impulse. And the pulmonary bay, it is not full, neither it is a thing. But reticular appearance indicate that there are plenty of collaterals. Okay, go ahead.
Then ma'am, I am showing the echocardiography. Ma'am, in the subcostal view, we can see that IVC is draining into the left-sided right atrium.
Okay, great.
And ma'am, the left atrium is right-sided and the pulmonary veins are draining into it.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Then ma'am, four-chamber view, there is left-sided right atrium, right-sided left atrium with a epsteinoid malformation of the right-sided AV valve and atretic left-sided AV valve. So ma'am, as the valve goes with the ventricle, and ma'am, in the latter images, both the great arteries are arising from these ventricles. So DORV is most common. So it is a right ventricle and it is AV discordance with LA with epsteinoid malformation of the tricuspid valve.
Okay.
Now, so ma'am, it is a mitral atresia.
Okay. Now, you know, if only one picture could be played, you know, that would have been very nice.
Okay, ma'am. I have actually, ma'am, auto-played all the videos.
Okay. Now, because for the audience, it may be difficult. So let us concentrate in the one by one. So here you can see that these are the hepatic veins and they're draining into the
left-sided right atrium, ma'am. Left-sided atrium.
Yeah. So, left-sided atria, whether it is the LA or the RA, how do you make out?
I should see for the appendages then.
Appendage, okay. The group is here, appendage is for the LV, and then the other one is left for the RA. Okay.
Yes,
so, here the appendage has to be seen. And what is important is the intra-atrial septum is bulging towards the LA.
But the LA. So, ma'am, that this atrial pressure is high.
Yes. Okay. So, this is the tricuspid valve and that is the mitral valve. So, there is a mitral valve atresia.
Yes, ma'am.
As a result, you know, the LV appears to be small. And
small, hypoplastic LV.
That is the reason in the palpation, you never had the apical impulse shifted downwards and laterally. And so it is unlikely to be done. So here the hypoplastic left ventricle, and then there is a mitral atresia. Usually tricuspid atresia is very common and mitral atresia is 0.03%. So extremely rare.
Extremely rare.
And one cannot make out the diagnosis of mitral atresia clinically. But however, you can make out that there is a heterotaxy, you can suspect, and you can also suspect the single ventricle physiology. So the single ventricular physiology can be made out, and here only echo can tell you what it is. And regarding the heterotaxy, the CT will be much better than the echocardiography.
Yes,
ma'am. The aortic arch. Now tell me how to make out it is a right-sided aortic arch or the left-sided aortic arch on the echocardiography.
If it is a right-sided aortic arch, then the first branch will be going to the left. If it divides, ma'am, then it is a mirror image. If it is not dividing, then aberrant left subclavian.
Okay, good. See, that is how you have to make out. Now, what is the importance of making out whether it's a right-sided aortic arch or the left-sided aortic arch?
Ma'am, absolutely, it is very much important because during the Glenn, the surgeon opens it. So if he knows that which sided arch, then it will be easier to make any BT shunt or Glenn to know the anatomy.
Exactly.
So vascular ring.
Yes. If a BT shunt, not in this case, if the BT shunt is contemplated, then knowing on which side to do the shunt is very important. So the right or the left aortic arch is important to decide which side the BT shunt has to be done. Now, do you have the short axis where the great arteries are seen?
Ma'am, yes, ma'am. In the next slide, ma'am.
Okay, so please.
Ma'am, this is the short axis.
Okay.
Aorta is on the anterior and to the right.
Okay, that's a large one. The what you see, the red and blue.
Yes,
the anterior and the superior is the aorta.
Yes, ma'am. And ma'am, posteriorly the branch PA, I cannot see the RPA. It is only the LPA.
Okay.
So the ma'am, right lung may be separated by MAPCA, and we will confirm it in the CT scan.
Okay. Now you have to realize that normally there is a cup and saucer lesion. The cup is formed by the aorta and the saucer is by the pulmonary artery. So in the short axis, you see the aorta like this and the pulmonary artery, RVOT, and then the pulmonary artery coming like this like this. Okay. So this is how the aorta will look in the center, like a single circular one, and the pulmonary artery will be encircling like this. But here you can see that aorta is more anterior and then the pulmonary artery is below. So that is more posterior. So that can happen in a DORV. Okay.
So it becomes DORV D-malpose. DORV DTG.
DTG. The D-malposition. So in a single ventricle, invariably you can have a normal related great arteries or you can have a transposition. If the normal related great arteries are there, we call it as the Holmes heart.
Holmes heart. Ma'am, it is less common.
Okay. But here it is not like a regular single ventricle. Here we are able to see the right ventricle. Left ventricle is there. It is more of a mitral atresia. So this is not like us. Physiology is like single ventricle, but literally it is not a single ventricle. Anatomically, it is not a single ventricle. Okay.
In the last but one, it is the RSVC, ma'am, right SVC, and there is a LSVC also, bilateral SVC is there. And I can see some collateral, ma'am, some collateral flow in the this video, ma'am. There are some collaterals.
Is there a duct?
So, ma'am, I could not find out a duct. I did the echo. There are some collaterals from the subclavian.
Okay. See, what happens is in such complex conditions, you do not get a duct in the regular position. Invariably, there will be a vertical duct which comes below the arch. So directly it will be coming down. So whether it is the vertical duct or it is the collateral, large aorta pulmonary collateral, it becomes difficult to make out. Now, What are the types of collaterals that you get in such a complex conjunction?
There are three types of collaterals. One is direct collateral, another is indirect. Direct is, ma'am, the branches of the DTA which anastomosis is with the hilar pulmonary arteries. Indirect, ma'am, the branches from the subclavian and the mammary arteries which supplies the pulmonary artery. And other is the, ma'am, bronchial collateral. These three types of collateral we can see.
Okay. What is the importance of knowing the collaterals? Why they are important?
But ma'am, the tunica intima and media, ma'am, the layering is different, ma'am. They form constriction and there is patchy areas of hypertensive and hypotensive areas of lung. That is, ma'am, collateral may be systemic pressure, and some collateral may cause anatomical narrowing and there is hypoperfusion. So it is okay. Very difficult to.
Not in this condition, but in the case of pulmonary atresia, where the unifocalization has to be done and the branches or these collaterals have to be brought to the pulmonary artery, there you have to know the anatomy and the pressure in these collaterals. So there, for the unifocalization, that is very important. Another thing, when the plenty of collaterals are there, post-surgically, they more invariably they come down. But sometimes, some of them do not, and they develop hemoptysis and sudden hypertension post-operatively. So to avoid the post-operative complications, you have to know the anatomy of the collaterals. And sometimes, as a cardiologist, you'll have to do the coil embolization to reduce the hemoptysis and control the hemoptysis and then bring back the blood pressure. So as a result, you have to know the collaterals, which type of collaterals are there. So bronchial collaterals are more likely to cause the rupture and the hemoptysis compared to the aorto pulmonary collaterals. But however, we have to know what type of the collaterals they are. Okay, go ahead.
Ma'am, I'm going to the CT scan. Ma'am, here it is a right arch, you can see.
Yeah.
And ma'am, I am showing that this is, ma'am, the LPA is good size, but the RPA is very narrow.
Yeah, it is a diffuse narrowing of the right pulmonary artery. Diffuse narrowing is there. Left pulmonary artery is very nicely seen. Aorta is big. And it is definitely right-sided aortic arch. Very nicely seen.
Okay. And there are different small collaterals from the DTA. We can see in the coronal. Right RPA is small.
They are quite huge collaterals. You can.
These are the collaterals.
Plenty of them. Okay.
We are planning to do CAT tomorrow, ma'am.
Now, when you are able to see everything, you are doing the CAT. Can you tell me why?
Yes, ma'am, so that we can hook the collateral at that level of the vertebra so that we can delineate.
With the CT, you can see where the collateral anatomy is there, but the pressure in the collateral cannot be made by the CT.
Yes, ma'am.
So ultimately, what we say that the CAT and angio is a gold standard.
Gold standard, yes.
It holds good despite the CT and the MR. Okay, now what about the spleen? Either splenia or polysplenia?
Liver is on the left side and the stomach is on the right side as reported in the CT scan.
Okay. The spleen. What about the spleen?
Ma'am, there is a spleen, ma'am, here. I can see.
I can see the spleen, yes.
Ma'am, abdominal situs is inversus.
Yeah, the spleen has come to the right side and the liver has come to the
left side.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So the liver is on to the left side and the spleen is to the right side. So that means that is the situs inversus. Okay. There is a situs inversus. Okay.
Ma'am, and there is bilateral SBC, ma'am. In this picture we can see. Now I have freeze. This is the RSBC, this is the LSBC.
Okay. So there is SVC as well as the LSVC. What is the significance of knowing the LSVC?
One thing is, if it is a single ventricle physiology, so we have to do bilateral Glenn.
Okay.
So number two, ma'am, if it is a hit.
both SVC and LSVC have to be connected to the pulmonary. Okay, so that is the importance.
And ma'am, in this case, ma'am, surgeon have to do RPAplasty because this is a bilateral gland candidate. Okay. RPA is narrow.
And apart from that, what happens is during the surgery, if the LSVC is neglected and the separate cannulation is not done, the area will be flooded with the blood.
So
now the LSVC has to be cannulated separately and they have to be connected to the pulmonary artery. So the, in a normal thing, the presence of LSVC or absence of LSVC doesn't make any difference because anyway it is draining into the coronary sinus and going normally. But during the surgery, it is very important to know the LSVC. So beautifully the LSVC, the two vertical things are nicely seen. Okay.
This is all, ma'am.
Okay, thank you very much. So any questions are there? Probably this is a very complex one for the students. And in the examination, even if you don't mention mitral atresia, and in fact, you should not mention at all because it is so very rare. And probably this is the sixth or the eighth case that I'm seeing, you know, it is that rare because I have seen thousands of congenitals and mitral atresia is extremely rare. And as a result, in the examination, you should not mention it that. So any questions from anybody? The chat box, let us see if there is if there are any questions.
Yes, ma'am. There is one question in the chat box from Abhay. He wants to know what the reason for dyspnea in a right heart pathology like tetralogy of Fallot is.
Okay, your answer.
Ma'am, in case of a TOF, as the child grows, the forward flow may decrease and there will be micro infarction of the ventricle. So there will be hypoxic injury and dysfunction of the ventricle. So this causes dyspnea on exertion, ma'am. Ventricular EDP will be more.
And the cyanosis itself can cause breathlessness.
Yes, ma'am.
The cyanosis itself. See, whenever there is a decreased desaturation is there, and that itself triggers what is like a herringbone reflex. You know, the stimulation will be there, and the tachypnea will be there, and the cyanosis itself causes. And apart from that, the RV dysfunction also will cause the breathlessness. Okay. Any other question?
No, ma'am. As of now, there are no more questions in the chat box.
Okay. Krishna Rao, any questions from your side or anything? Jagdish Patil? If there are no questions from anyone, then we can conclude. And I can say that Jayatri has done a wonderful presentation because this is a very complex one. And in the examination, this will be kept as a long case if they don't have the other cases. And even if the attenders tell you that it is a mitral atresia, you should not commit in the examination and say it is a mitral atresia. Otherwise, the examiner will think that you know the diagnosis. So, like how we have analyzed systematically, first say it is a cyanotic congenital heart disease, then you have to say it is a decreased pulmonary blood flow, then you have to tell whether it is an RV type or the LV type, and then you have to tell whether it is the aortic click or the pulmonary artery click, and then you have to come to the single ventricle physiology. So, this is how step by step you have to come. And by exclusion, you have to make the diagnosis rather than making the diagnosis.